In the verse of these songs we sing, hallelujah, I feel good. And when we come to that hallelujah, I want you to shout hallelujah. So let's practice. Are you ready? One, two, three.
Hallelujah!
Okay, here we go. We need to go there to Calvary daily. Let's go.
Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Thank you for that music. Those of you that are helping with that, appreciate that. Welcome to Camp Creek this morning. Those of you here in person, those of you watching us online or watching the taped version of this, thank you for being a part of our worship service this morning. If you take out your bulletins, let's just look at some of the things that are going on in the life of the church. Again, you'll see in your bulletins November's calendars. So get those placed where you can see them. Just a note that next Sunday morning early is our time change. So we get to fall back an hour. We talked about that in Sunday school. That means we get an extra hour next Sunday morning. So people should be here early, right? We decided that never works anyway. So trunk or treat is this afternoon from 4 to 6 at the school. It's going to be there in the parking lot. And continue to be in prayer for that. Those of you that have volunteered to help, just thank you for that. Be there and can help. And we hope to have a good time, a good turnout. The weather seems to be like it might be fairly nice. So, again, we just look forward to that and those that are participating in that. Your church offerings can be placed in the box in the back on the round table. Can be mailed to the church or submitted online, as you see our church website up there. And we thank you for those. In the back, on the counter, is our directories. We'd like for you to check and make sure your information is correct in those directories, so that once we get them published, it will be correct. Roger gave me two potential copies that he's going to be making. A smaller version like we've had in the past. This is the large print version for those of us like me that can't see very well. But anyway, just so you know, and correct Roger, next Sunday there might be some of these out, okay? So again, if you can check your data today, that would be great, so we can get these printed this week. That'd be very nice. Thank you. Mom's group meets Thursday the 4th from 9 to 11. We also have World Missionary Press on the 4th, and if your names are in the bulletin there, and you're not going to be able to be there, if you can find someone to replace you so that the work of the press can go on, that would be appreciated. Ladies' Aid is Tuesday the 9th here at the church from 9 to 3. Again, just a note about our Right Now Media subscription. Again, if you would like that and do not have that, there's information there in the bulletin about what you can do to get that. Get your name on the list in the back, or again, the other ways that you can do that. Roger's hours are typically 9 to 2 here at the church. Just a note that he is going to be out of the office on Tuesday morning and Wednesday for continuing education purposes. So if you need to touch base with him, please feel free to call him, text him, email him, and he'd be more than happy to reach back to you and get in touch with you. Just a note for those of you that are involved in Bible memory, we will not be having lessons next week. We're going to push those off until the second Sunday in November. So lessons will be on the 14th for those of you that are affected by that. Anything that I missed this morning that needs to be announced? Okay, let's see if Steve can not forget Memory Minute this morning. So, Jada, are you ready?
John 19:17. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull. John 19:17.
Okay, so I think now we have a special presentation. So who is giving that? Connor and Caden. All right, guys.
So it is Pastor Appreciation Month, and we'd like to thank Roger and Stacy, and Anita put this together, so we're just here for help. It goes, extra, extra, read all about it. Our pastor is the coolest in the Milky Way. Let's take five to say thank you. Camp Creek was in a crunch, and we needed a pastor. God provides. We scored when Roger and Stacy say yes, left their family and friends to move to Indiana. An outrageous blessing to Camp Creek, adding mounds of music, lots of energy, and the cutest three musketeers ever.
Our amazing pastor preaches from the Word, teaches with stories and chuckles, crosses his T's and dots his I's, guides us through the sour patch of COVID, shares faith, food, and joy with our youth. We love you to pieces, so here's an extra check before payday.
Again, thank you, Roger and Stacy, for being a part of our congregation and ministering to us and through us. We appreciate you very much.
Thank you, Connor and Kate, and thank you, Anita. That was unexpected this morning. Appreciate that. And that was a really fun way to do it. That's, I think, probably the neatest way we've done it the last 5 years. So. The kids will get to eat the candy. Yep, they're looking forward to it. I could already see it on their faces. So.
Ryan, no. Do you have more slides? Do you have more slides for this? No. Okay. Thank you.
Do want to thank you as a church for that, and also I've received many pastor appreciation cards. On the Sunday I was sick, I got a lot of encouraging notes as well, and just thank you for just uplifting me in prayer. But encouraging me as well in those many ways that you're doing. Also, my office yesterday was full of candy. I've hauled that out to my truck yesterday, but thank you for all of the donations of candy for Trunk or Treat as well. That'll be this afternoon. We're looking forward to ministering in the community there. Just a quick update, I am doing better. A lot of you have asked me this morning how I'm doing, and I'm feeling better. I'm sure there's probably some lingering things that maybe I'm not taking note of, but just feeling a lot better than what I was. I got kind of knocked down by the sickness, so definitely feeling better. It wasn't COVID, wasn't the flu, wasn't strep throat. They know those things, but I'm guessing it was probably like a hand, foot, and mouth disease type thing that kids brought home from school. So just thank you for your prayers. Really appreciated those. I probably missed a lot over the last couple of weeks, but I did see this week that Carson Lemler had surgery, and that went well. So continue to pray for healing there. From what I know, he was just up and kind of running around like normal. So, and then I saw Ryan Williamson got home safe yesterday. He had been traveling over in Europe doing some missions work over there and training. So thankful for his safe return back to Florida as well. Are there any other updates or additional prayer requests or praises anyone would like to mention this morning?
Steve and I have a praise. The reason we won't be here next week is that our granddaughter Addie is going to be baptized, and so we're going to witness that and celebrate that with her. It's neat to see the next generation. Mm-hmm. It's such a blessing to see the next generation.
Definitely. Yes.
A few years ago at Revival, we had Pastor Mike Roush from the Napanee Living Gospel Church. His wife, Paul, he passed away yesterday. She's had a long, long battle with cancer.
Mm-hmm. And if you didn't hear that, Dawn mentioned that Mike Roush, who's been a speaker here for Revival, his wife, Pauline, passed away. So be in prayer for his family. Any other requests or praises anyone wants to mention? All right, let's spend some time in prayer. Father, we thank you, God, that you are bigger than all of our problems. God, that you are bigger than the issues we face in life. God, that we can rejoice. We can shout hallelujah because of the salvation that we have assurance of. God, we worship you for the many ways that you work in and through us every day. God, the ways that we notice and the ways that go unnoticed because you are faithful and you are good and you are loving to your people. God, I lift up the requests that were mentioned this morning. Father, we thank you for working in my household, just for healing there. God, for Carson, as he's healing from his surgery, God, just pray that you would work in their family life. God, that Jason and Lisa would just be able to care for him, God, as he's full of energy. God, pray for Trunk or Treat this afternoon. God, that you would be evident there, that we would be able to, through handing out gospel tracts and just talking with neighbors and friends and community members, be able to share the gospel with them. Father, we thank you for Addie, just taking that step of faith to proclaim that she wants to be baptized. God, I pray that you would just bless that day. Bless Steve and Cindy as they go and watch her take that step. Father, we pray for Mike Roush and his family. God, as they're mourning the death of Pauline as she's been facing this struggle with cancer for so long. God, I pray that you would be with him and his children and those in their church family as they're trying to find ways to help and serve in the midst of all that he's going through. Father, I pray that you would allow him to take the time he needs in order to grieve, in order to mourn the loss of his wife, and God, that you would provide for all of his needs in the midst of this time. Father, I pray for our congregation. God, I thank you for our music this morning. I thank you for the community we had through donuts and our Sunday school classes, and God, just the time we've had this morning to share with one another, to pray with one another, to be a part of each other's lives throughout this morning. Father, I pray we continue to shine your light into this community and spread your word to those who need to hear it. I pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
For our worship song this morning, we're going to sing an old hymn, Trust and Obey.
Thank you.
So kids, go ahead and be dismissed to Children's Church this morning. We've been working through our series called Evidence. It's a study of the book of 1 John, written by John the Apostle. John the witness who was there, who saw Jesus, who was there during all of his ministry and in the time of his life here on earth. John who raced with Peter to witness the empty tomb. John who saw Jesus resurrected and saw the spots in his hands and his feet where the nails had been. John who had been a witness to all of those things. John writes this text, and he's writing to believers in the church. We talked about how he's writing to believers in Asia Minor, and he's talking, trying to battle against some of the false teaching that's happening, some of the false teachers that are trying to draw away the Christians, draw away the believers from what they first learned, from what Paul and John and others had been there and had taught them. He's trying to encourage them in the ways that they can know that they have eternal life, the ways that they know that they're members of the family of God, that they are sons and daughters. They have been adopted by God. John talks some in his book about love multiple times. And what is love? Is love flowers? Is love candy? Is love cards? I think those could be a part of showing you love someone. Our culture would say that love is a set of emotions and behaviors that are characterized by intimacy, passion, and commitment. But in this chapter, we get a different definition of what love is, what biblical love is. It's in 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. If you have your Bibles, I encourage you to open them to that. 1 John chapter 4, we're going to start in verse 7. And God gives us a different view of what love is through the example he gives us in his Son and that which he sets forth in his Word. So we're going to look at God's perfect demonstration of love. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Let's read it this morning. John writes, "Beloved," one of his terms he loves to use for this church family that he's writing to. He also calls them children over and over again. But he says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God." Verse 16, "So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment, because as he is, so also we are in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because he first loved us. Verse 20, if anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. John's talking about the love of God in here, and he really gets at the heart of why love is important. God's love, John covers it three different times in the book of 1 John. First in chapter 2, verses 7 through 11, John focuses on that love for the brethren, love for those who are believers, is evidence of fellowship with God. Love for the brethren is evidence of fellowship with God. Secondly, he says that love is evidence of sonship. So the fact that we are children of God, we are heirs through Christ, our love is the evidence of those things, that we have come into that family relationship, that beloved, that children relationship. That's how John refers to his broader congregation here. And so finally, we get to John chapter 4, and John really gets into the whole why. Why is it important that we love the brothers? Why is it important that love is our evidence of our sonship? Well, the reason is this. Love is necessary because it's part of God's character. It's part of God's character. It's part of who he is. When we talk about love, this agape style love, and weeks ago, we talked about the agape love. I think when we first talked about it in chapter 2, verse 7, we talked about how this is a different style of love, that this is a sacrificial love that is given of yourself, not expecting anything in return. And so this part of love is just a part of God's nature, a part of his character, a part of who he is. So John is going to communicate what it looks like for this love to be perfectly demonstrated. So how is God's love perfectly demonstrated? The first point is love flows from God. Love flows from God. Think of God's love like a stream of water that is flowing out of God and flowing towards his creation, flowing towards his people. That love is flowing out of God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. It's flowing out of the Trinity towards creation. And in Romans chapter 5, Paul points out that God shows his love for us and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. We weren't cleaned up. We weren't all fancy. We weren't all nice looking. God's love flowed out towards us despite the fact that we were ugly in our sinfulness. We were like pigs in the muck. But God still said, I love this creation so much that I'm going to send my son. You see, God's love is not dependent upon our love for him or our affection towards him. Because, John says, God is love. One of the authors I read when I was preparing for this, David Jackman, he says, John is not identifying a quality which God possesses. He's making a statement about the essence of God's being. It is not simply that God loves, but that he is love. The two cannot be separated. God is love. Love is just flowing out of God. It's part of who he is. Secondly, love is demonstrated through the Father's sacrifice. Verses 9 and 10, it says, "In this the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins." You see, God's love is not what saves us. Jesus Christ on the cross is what saves us, but God's love is what initiated Christ being on the cross. The two are interrelated and interconnected there. Most of us could quote John 3:16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life," or have everlasting life. God loved the world so much. It was the initiator. It was like the lighting of the fuse of the bomb. God lit the fuse. That was his love that initiated it. But Jesus Christ on the cross, his death, burial, and resurrection is what saves us. God's love being poured out through Jesus. You see, God's love is what initiates Christ's sacrifice, what initiates his mercy, what initiates his grace, what initiates his justice. God's love is what initiates all of those things. Because apart from God and God being love, those things have to be loving mercy, loving grace, loving sacrifice, loving justice, because God is love. All of the things God does, he does in love, even when he punishes, even when he corrects, even when he rebukes, he does those things in love. If you're a parent, I'm sure you can understand that a little bit better. Because as a parent, sometimes you don't want to have to punish your kids. You don't want to have to rebuke them. You don't want to have to correct them. You don't want to have to, but you do because you love them. And so all of the characteristics of God are poured out because of his love. Third, God's love is designed to be shared. So this is why back in chapter 2, verse 7, John began to talk about how our love is shown to those who are fellow believers. It's designed to be shared. It's not meant to be kept to ourselves. God's love is flowing from him, from his throne, towards those who are his believers. But then it's meant to flow through us into others. The design of God's love is not meant to be hoarded or kept to yourself, but it's designed to be shared with other fellow believers, those who don't know God. It's designed to be shared with them as well. God says that, John says that God's love is perfected in us. That term perfected there means that it's completed, that it's matured in us. So we play a role in God's love. We have a responsibility in God's love. For God's love to be perfected in us, it means that we are sharing it with others. It means God's love is perfected. It's shown the best when we are loving each other. When we are demonstrating our love for each other in sacrificial ways. Sometimes that's time. Sometimes that's doing a task. Sometimes that's helping in another way, just praying for people. It's designed to be shared. John Stott says this, God's love for us is perfected only when it is reproduced in us, or as it may mean, among us in the Christian fellowship. So God's love is perfected in us when it is demonstrated towards others. God's love is meant to be used. In verses 19 through 21, John kind of gives a counter argument. He says in verse 19, we love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. John's already given us this argument before. If you say you love God and you're not loving your brother, then you're not actually loving God. For he who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. John's saying, you see the people. If you look around the church, you see people here today. If we don't love the people we can see, how are we to love God whom we cannot see? That's what he's saying. He's saying it should be easier for us to love each other. And yet I'm sure at that time, John was hearing of conflicts. Conflicts happened in the church. Read through the pastoral letters in the New Testament. Paul over and over and over again is dealing with these conflicts that are happening. Conflicts happen, but the command is to love fellow believers. John said back in chapter 3, verse 17, he says, but if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? If you see a brother in need and you do nothing, you don't pray for them, you have goods, you can say, hey, I have some food for you, or you need a ride because your car broke down, or whatever that is, and you do nothing, John's saying, how does God's love abide in you? Frank Gabeline says, if the children of God must be holy because he is holy, and there's references there for that, and merciful because he is merciful, from Luke 6:36, so they must be loving because he is loving. Because God is love, God's children are also supposed to be love. Remember how I talked about how we're supposed to have family resemblance. These are the traits that we're supposed to be showing and resembling, that we are a child of our Heavenly Father, that we are a son and heir along with Jesus Christ. We're to be holy because he is holy. We're to be merciful because he is merciful. And we are to be loving because he is loving. The first part of these verses have communicated how God demonstrated his love, how that was done perfectly. The second part, John kind of turns his focus from describing God's love to looking at the evidences or the results of his love in our lives. How are these to be played out? So the demonstration of love first is confirmation of the Holy Spirit's indwelling. Confirmation of the Holy Spirit's indwelling. If you're showing the love of God to others, John would argue, then you are showing evidence of the Holy Spirit being in your life. You're loving others, that is an evidence that the Holy Spirit is in you. And so John begins to give this circular reasoning of a sort that says that if God's love is in you, God's Spirit is in you. And if God's Spirit is in you, then God's love is in you, and that should be being demonstrated. So a way or an evidence of God's love being demonstrated is that we're loving other people, and that's showing that the Holy Spirit is indwelling us. Second demonstration of love is communication of the gospel. Communication of the gospel. John again reminds the believers that he was there. I talked about that. John saw Jesus. John witnessed Jesus. John touched Jesus. John leaned up against Jesus. John was on the boat out fishing with Jesus, afraid when Jesus fell asleep on the boat and there was a storm that came up. John was there. He was an eyewitness to Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. So now, as Christians, we rely on the firsthand accounts of those who were there. We rely on the biblical text. We rely on authors that wrote down the message of the gospel in order to communicate it to us so that we could know about Jesus. And now, in turn, this gospel, the gospel of Jesus' life, death, burial, and resurrection, is our job to communicate. It has been entrusted with the church, his people, to communicate the gospel to others who do not know it, who have not heard it. Not only do we have his word, but we also have firsthand accounts of our own lives, of what the gospel has done in our hearts and in our minds and in our spirit. We have those firsthand accounts. Nobody can say that did not happen to you, because you know the power of what the gospel, of what God's word has done in your life. That is a firsthand account you have of the gospel. That is another part of communicating the gospel. It's not just talking about Jesus, but it's talking about what Jesus has done for you. Third, it's a confirmation of God's active presence. As we're communicating the gospel, acknowledging Jesus is the one who saves us from our sins, that he is ruler over our lives, it's confirming God's active presence in our life. The fact that he has saved us from our sins, that he's ruling over our lives. Do you remember in the Old Testament, God brought the nation out of Egypt? And then Moses went up on the mountain and met with God. Well, as the people begin to move from there, God commands them to build a tabernacle, a spot where he can come down and he can be with the people. So as they traveled, God was with them. A cloud by day, a pillar of fire by night, coming down and being in the temple, speaking with Moses. That was God's presence, walking and dwelling with the people. But because of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, God's presence can now be within people through the Holy Spirit. God's active presence is no longer limited to the tabernacle or the temple that would later be built. Because as the New Testament writers tell us, our bodies are now the temple of the Holy Spirit, where he indwells us. It's a confirmation of his active presence. Fourth, it's a deepening knowledge and understanding of God's love. deepening knowledge and understanding of God's love. So as we're displaying God's love, as God's love is flowing through us out into others, whether that be our family or our church family or the community that we're in, it begins to deepen our knowledge and understanding of God's love. The Spirit guides us in a deeper understanding, a broader understanding of what God's love looks like. We recognize that it's only through the Holy Spirit's work that we are able to love in that way. We are able to show God's love because the Holy Spirit is indwelling us because God is love. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 3, it starts in verse 14. Paul writes this, "For this reason I bow my knees." He basically, in the middle of the text, remember when we were studying Ephesians quite a while ago, Paul would just break out into prayers, and this was one of them in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. He's writing, and all of a sudden he's praying for the people. He says, "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love," what kind of love? That agape love, being rooted and grounded because it's flowing from God like a stream, "may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge." Well, if it surpasses knowledge, Paul, how are we supposed to know it? That's my question. Through the Holy Spirit, through God's love being perfected in us and demonstrated to others. We begin to scratch the surface of understanding the breadth, length, height, and depth of God's love. He says that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. How full is God? Very full, and you're being filled with that. Filled with all the fullness of God. Finally, the demonstration of love gives us confidence in our future. Confidence in our future. His love is perfected in us as we are demonstrating it in sacrificial ways. John writes that we have no reason to fear judgment, because we know the Holy Spirit is living within us because we're demonstrating God's love. And so we can have confidence in our future. We can have confidence in our destiny. We know where we are going. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, verse 16, it says, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace. We can come to God in prayer with confidence. Everybody say confidence. 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 That's a good, confident way to say that. We can proceed towards God knowing, having assurance that we are his children. That we're going to receive mercy and find grace. So the question becomes, am I demonstrating God's love to others? Am I showing God's love? Am I loving others as God has loved me? Because God's love was demonstrated for us through Jesus Christ. Verse 9, chapter 4. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. God sacrificially loved his people. So am I showing others? Do I desire to show God's love, his perfect love, in the way that he has offered it to me? So on the back side of your sheets, there's some practical application that I put there. Recognize God's amazing love for you demonstrated through Jesus' sacrifice, both from John 3:16 and Romans 5:8. Understand that God loves you as his child, 1 John 3:1. Understand God's love will not be taken from you. And see that God's love fills you through the Holy Spirit, that there's that interconnection there, that God's love is filling you through his Holy Spirit. And as that is happening, it says we abide with Jesus. Jesus abides with the Father. There's that connection there. And then that love is flowing out of us towards others. And I listed a couple of ways you could pray there. God, help me to recognize and accept your love today. Because sometimes we have a hard time accepting his love. We know it here, but we don't experience his actual love. Help me be filled with your love, and help me to show your love to others. Would you pray with me this morning? Father, we have a hard time almost even comprehending your love. That you loved us so much, so greatly, even in the midst of our sinfulness and our wickedness, you loved us enough to send your Son to die for us. God, the agony that he went through, the pain that he endured. Father, we thank you for your love. Your love that initiated creation coming into existence. Your love that brought the results, the consequences of sinfulness. That you said there must be something, that it must be just. That there needs to be a payment for sin. And then the fact that you were the one who gave the ultimate payment for sin. You demonstrated your love for humanity, for the world, through Jesus Christ, death on the cross, his payment for our sins, the payment that was established all the way back in Genesis chapter 3. God, thank you for your love. God, help us receive your love. Help us recognize your love. Help us demonstrate your love to others. Show it in tangible ways, in sacrificial ways. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Make a way.
God's love flows from him. The only way we have power to love others in this way is because of God's love. Paul, in the verses we read earlier, that prayer, I didn't quite finish it. The last two verses in Ephesians chapter 3, it says, "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us." What is that power? That's the love of God working through us. "To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." Have a great week. God bless.